Good evening and welcome to our marriage class. Tonight is Friday, January the 14th, 2021. Well, I can't leave 2021, 2022. Amen. So, you know, it's always, you know, honorable and a privilege and humbling, you know, to sit on this side of the screen and teach you some findings in the Word of God, you know, and through my own personal life, being married for this coming July will be 40 years together and 41 altogether. We're really excited about, you know, helping, you know, young couples, those who are even contemplating, you know, to get married, they're dating right now, courting, or you know, and then those who are struggling in their marriage, those who threw in the towel, you know, this message is good for all of us, okay? I want to welcome our Instagram viewers. Thank you so much, you know, for tuning in. And also our Facebook live audience. If you can, hit your like and your share, tag some names, and let's, I mean, you know somebody, you know, that's, you know, thinking about getting married, you know, someone, you know, that's struggling, you know, this is a good time, you know, for them to get a word, you know, to, I don't know, you know, for the decision makings that they're about to make. Okay, so tonight I'll be talking to you, you know, about a topic, you know, that this will be the fifth time I taught it. And I find myself coming back, you know, here to this topic, you know, because unless we get this, you know, like you can't buy love, you can't cook love, you can't, you can do whatever, you know, it is possible, you know, to sustain your marriage or keep your marriage, you know, fresh, you know, but without this, you know, it's going to be tough. So I'd rather start off the brand new year 2022, you know, with this topic that's called the two keys for marriage to work. So if you want your marriage to work, you know, then this is what you're going to need. Okay, sweetheart, see if you can tag More Lucky on Instagram, if you can. The two keys for marriage to work. All right. You know, almost every marriage, you know, they start out, you know, with the huge ready wedding celebration, you know, the planning, you know, the decorations, the color coordination, the food tasting, and all of that, you know, that goes on into bringing a couple, you know, to the altar. You know, the question is, you know, is why isn't that we put that much energy into, you know, making our marriage work? You know what I mean? I mean, we spend so much money, you know, only, I've heard of a marriage, you know, that was, they got married and they were divorced within minutes. They got an annulment, you know, and some of them, you know, say, you know, that they were drunk when they got married, and when they were sober, you know, they recognized what they did. And so they just, you know, so, but that's how it all starts off. You know, it starts off, you know, with all the, you know, the fanfare and, you know, the glitter and all that stuff, you know. Standing there together, you know, with family and friends, you know, witnessing, you know, two people full of hopes, you know, and dreams, you know, for an exciting future together, you know. But the reason for a marriage class is because the road to happy marriage, a road to a happy marriage, is far from easy. It's far from, you know, a picture perfect. You know, you see movies and you see, you know, love novels and things like that. You know, marriage, on the other hand, is hard work. Marriage is hard work. But I want to show you something, you know, that that I wish, you know, I learned earlier, then I wouldn't have had to, you know, go through a lot of the difficulties that Fia and I went through, you know, had I known, you know, the two keys, you know, to make a marriage work. So, and today's, you know, divorce rate, you know, demonstrates all too well, you know, I mean, the divorce rate in the church is 50%, which means for every two marriages, there's a divorce. And the divorce rate in the church is the same as the divorce rate in the world. You know what I mean? So there's something wrong here, you know, because if that's the case, then my question is, what is the difference, you know, with what we're doing in church and what the world is doing out there? You know, that many couples, you know, opt not to fulfill their vows. You know what I mean? Much less, you know, the journey. You know what I mean? So, and it's all easy for us, you know, to blame our marital, you know, failures, you know, on not enough quality time together, or, you know, there's too much bitterness and resentment, you know, and then they fail to communicate, you know, and the list goes on and on and on. You know, we can always, you know, say this is the reason, that's the reason, you know. We can always say not enough money, you know. We can always say it's the bills and things like that, you know. And even with good parents, you know, even with a good pastor, you know, good family, friends, you know, their blessings, you know, even with their blessings upon the marriage, you know, and even the books, you know, that we read on marriage and love seminars and things like that, you know, many marriages are on life support. You know what I mean? So marriage is a much more deeper issue. It's something, you know, that's, it's way, way, more complicated than, what we've done here on the surface. You know what I mean? Like say for instance, you know, my ring, you know, and my wife's ring, as a matter of fact, you know, like my ring and my wife's ring, you know, I didn't buy it. You know what I mean? I mean, my mother, you know, was so excited about the fact that, you know, we had the whole spiel, you know, we had the wedding, what you call that thing before the wedding? Engagement party. We had the whole engagement party and everything, you know. And so, to be honest with you, you know, my wife and I, we really don't know how much our rings cost, you know. But you know what? Our love was just far greater than, you know, the ring, you know. So now that we're, you know, we've been together, you know, we're going on to 40 years, you know, together, you know, it's, you know, marriage is far deeper than just, you know, having a, you know, like the world say, you know, put a ring on it. You know what I mean? It's far deeper than that. You know what I'm saying? So, and until the true purpose for marriage is known, you know what I mean? No amount of, you know, external behavior, you know what I mean, or modification and, you know, and changes, none will work. You know, I don't care what you buy, you know, nothing will work. You know, so let's talk about that. All right, let's talk about the two keys, you know, for marriage to work. We're going to look at a scripture, right? You know, there's two keys in these verses for a marriage, for a good marriage to work, you know, and even for a marriage that's on the brink, you know, to take a turn, and it'll work if they can catch this. When you catch this, when you get these two keys and you apply it to your marriage, you know what? Your marriage is going to a whole nother level, because like I said, marriage is just a much more deeper issue than, you know, things. You got it? So I'm going to take you to Matthew chapter 22, verse 35, and then we're going to read to verse 40, and I'm going to show you I'm gonna show you what it is, you know, the deep insights and concepts of this divine, you know, this divine partnership, you know, of two people coming together. And the scripture says, you know, then one of them, a lawyer, asked Jesus, a question, you know, to test him, and saying, verse 36, teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Which is the greatest commandment in the law? And verse 37, Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. That's critical right there, okay? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Verse 38, this is the first and great commandment. Verse 39, and then the second is just like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And verse 40, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Do we stop for you? You know, hang all and on these. Let me read that again. So we're going to read these two keys that's hidden in these verses. All right, Matthew 22, 35 to 40, New King James Version. Then one of them, a lawyer, asked Jesus, you know, a question, testing him and saying, verse 36, teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Verse 37, and Jesus said to him, you shall love the Lord your God. You shall love the Lord your God. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Verse 38, this is the first and great commandment. And verse 39, and the second is like it, just like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Verse 40, on these two commandments hang all the law of the prophets. Okay, so now notice what Jesus said, because we're talking about the greatest commandment, right? The two greatest commandment, right? And he said, you shall love the Lord your God. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Now, catch this, everyone. It's very hard, you know, for me to love Fia if I don't love God. You see what I'm saying? Because God provided us these two commandments that if we live by it, then really it, you know, like whatever flaws that come with Fia and whatever flaws that come with Alex, we're going to work things out. You know why? Because our love goes far beyond just our love for each other. Our love is that we love God with all of our heart, mind, and soul. You see what I'm saying? And because of that love, you know, it just changes the trajectory of our love for each other. You follow? And so now we can see that loving is not enough to maintain a healthy marriage. Just loving each other, you know, me loving Fia and Fia loving me, is not enough. It's not enough. And because God is the author and he's the finisher of our marriage, he's the one, you know, marriage is a God idea because he's the author of this idea of marriage, you know. So I and Fia and I, we should pay close attention why it is, you know, that we need to love the Lord thy God with all of our heart, mind, and soul. You see what I'm saying? So our material problem, you know, so when you open up the situation of marriage, you know, if our material problem can be traced back, you know, our material problems can be traced back to one or both, you know, partners, right? Failing to abide by these two laws. I'm sorry, our marital problems. our marital problems can be traced back to, you know, either Fia or me, you know, failing to abide by these two laws. You see what I'm saying? So if something happens, you know, for with our love towards each other, you can always trace it back to the fact that we really don't love God. Because if we really love God with our heart, mind, and soul, then you know what? Then we're going to love each other, because this union is not based on our love for each other, but it's based on our love for God. So keep in mind, marriage is God's original idea, and it's a plan that's divorce proof. You know what I'm saying? That it is guaranteed, you know, that your marriage is going to last forever if you understand that marriage came from God. It's a God original idea. So law number one, Jesus said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And then he said, verse 38, this is the first and great commandment. Law number two, and the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Verse 40, on these two commandments hang all the law of the prophets. You see what I'm saying? No matter what it is, no matter all the laws, anything from law of gravity to the law, 10 commandments, you know, the first five commandments is laws that pertains to man and God. Excuse me. And then the last five commandments pertain to man and man. You follow that? You know, like man to man. Thou shalt not kill. I'll never kill. You know why? Because I love the Lord my God with all of my heart, soul, and mind. Thou shalt not commit adultery. So you won't if you love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. I will not bow down to other gods. To other gods, if you see what I'm saying, if I love the Lord my God. So that, you know, the neighbor, you know, love thy neighbor, or, you know, love thy neighbor as yourself. The neighbor is not, it's not talking about the, you know, the family living next to you. Your neighbor is anyone next to you, including your spouse, you know, loving your spouse or loving your wife. That's what it's talking about, the neighbor. So the same is true with any relationship. You follow? The minute we begin to focus on our own wants and needs, catch this, everyone, over those of God, we're destined for trouble. The moment we take our eyes off of the fact that, you know, the first greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, you know, and then the second one is just like it, to love your neighbor, as yourself, you know. So I gotta love Fia as if she is me, and then vice versa, right? So let me say it again. The minute or the moment we begin to focus on our own wants, the minute or the moment we begin to focus on our own needs over those of God, you know, we're destined for trouble. So I'm going to ask you a series of questions. I'm going to show you how, you know, how deep this is, okay? Because, look, the question here, one of the questions is, are you experiencing communication problems, right? Another question is, how often do you really listen to what your partner has to say? The other question is, are you feeling bitterness and resentment growing towards your partner? Another question is, when was the last time you truly thanked God for your spouse? And then another question is, have you called your pastor and scheduled a marital counseling session? Now, with that said, those questions, I want you to listen very carefully, all right, as we consider these questions. Let's consider these questions, because your focus begins to shift away from you and your desires and over to God as you answer these questions. You see what I'm saying? Let's go back to the questions. Are you experiencing communication problems, right? So if you're experiencing communication problems, are you communicating with God? You will see that a lot of the issues that we're dealing with will shift over to God Once you hear these questions, how often do you really listen to what your partner has to say? Are you feeling bitterness and resentment going towards, you know, your partner? What was the last time, when was the last time you truly thanked God for your spouse? So as we consider, again, these questions, your focus begins to shift away from you and your desires and over to God, who knows what's best for us, who knows what's best for you, who knows what's best for me. You know, communication problems begin to improve once you recognize these questions, you know, that we just asked. Communication problems begins to improve. Anger and resentment slowly fades away. And now it's easier to communicate when you go back to where is your love foundation at? You follow what I'm saying? Is your marriage and your union love based on just you two? Or is it first to God? You follow? And then to each other. So we want to see change. We won't see changes overnight. Of course, you know, I've taught this for, this is my fifth time teaching this, you know, and then, you know, but, you know, like, I know a lot of my friends and families are not watching, which is why I ask you to hit your like and hit your share, tag some names, is because, you know, like, I'm teaching a marriage class in which, these are some principles that Fee and I live by. And I want them to hear it as well, you know. So we won't see changes overnight. I mean, because think about it. You have other issues, right? Financial pressures, you know, child rearing issues, and other problems that are beyond, you know, your control. You know, so you got other things that you have to be, you know, have to tend to, you know, besides, you know, your love for each other. Marriage is hard work. I'm gonna say that again, but if you commit your relationship, listen to me very carefully, okay? If you commit your relationship to God, if you commit your relationship to God, like say you're angry right now and you're saying, you know, like, you know what, I'm gonna do something crazy, man. All you got to do is go back, you know, to your commitment, you know, to your love for God. Because when you go back to your love for God, you know, and now you know that the marriage is not based on your love for each other, because love for each other is not enough to keep a marriage going. You follow? If you commit your relationship to God, who's the author of marriage, who's the one that know everything about marriage, and make a conscious decision to make God your partner first. Make God your partner first. There's a whole bunch of divorces right now. It wouldn't take place had they, you know, had they, you know, recommit their relationship to God. You know what I mean? Your marriage, you know, will weather any storm. You know, if you go back to God, what God said, and naturally, plenty of fun times, you know, keep showing up along the way when you do so. Question: are you struggling to find happiness in your marriage? Right? Because it's time. If you're having trouble finding, you know, happiness in your marriage, you know, then it's time to invite God to direct your marriage. How do you do that? So it's not just asking God, you know, to direct your marriage. Is that you got to go into the Word. You got to call your pastor, you know what I mean, and schedule a marital counseling, you know, so we can bring up some God scriptures from the Bible. You follow what I'm saying? That's how we're going to let God direct our marriage. Jesus is saying these two laws must be understood in order for your marriage to work. Let's go there. Let's Matthew chapter 22, 37 to 40. Again, you know, as we close, Jesus said to them, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart," not your spouse. Don't love your husband with all your heart. Don't love your wife with all your heart. First, love God with all your heart. And you know what? You'll automatically love your wife or love your husband with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. Verse 38, this is the first and great commandment. 39, and the second is just like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. You see the order? You love God first, right? And then you can love each other. And it says, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law of the prophets." You see what I'm saying? So in closing, your covenant and I want you to catch this, okay, is not made to each other. Your covenant or your vows, though made to each other, but it's not made to each other. Your covenant was made unto the Lord. Your covenant was made unto the Lord. And for that purpose, no matter what storms come your way, the marriage will be everlasting. Of course, you know, all this is so easy to say, right? But I mean, I got 40 years. I got 40 years plus 1 year, you know, we dated. So 41 years together. Case in point, God instructed Hosea to marry a prostitute. Listen to that, everyone. I mean, like what? I mean, God told Hosea to marry a prostitute. Here we are, you know, we're saying, you know, there's no way in the world, you know, I'm going to let my husband and let my wife, you know, go sleep with another person. But God told Hosea to marry a prostitute. You know, so Gomer was his wife, was Hosea's wife during the day, right? But during the night, she was out there prostituting. Wow. And Hosea's love for God was so deep that he obeyed God's commandment. And he understood well that she was his wife during the day, but she was someone else's, you know, during the night. Why is that? Because of his love for God. But now, he also understood why God did that, because God wanted to show the people. He said, I want the people to know that they're treating me the same way. You follow what I'm saying? Why is that? Because marriage is about fulfilling God's purpose. Marriage is about fulfilling God's purpose. I'm going to say that one more time. Marriage is about fulfilling God's purpose. What's the purpose? He said, I want you to be fruitful. Okay, you can't be fruitful with just you alone. He said, I want you to multiply. You can't multiply, you see what I'm saying? Unless you produce children, and then your children, you know, produce children. Be fruitful, multiply, replenish. You follow what I'm saying? So that means if you're a good father, you want to be able to reproduce another good father, reproduce another. You follow what I'm saying? Fruitful, multiply, replenish, subdue, and then have dominion, meaning conquer the situations in your marriage. Because marriage is about fulfilling God's purpose. It's not about fulfilling our needs and our purpose. Marriage is about fulfilling God's purpose, which is to fulfill all of our needs. Excuse me, which fulfills all of our needs as well. You got that, everybody? Well, that's our message for tonight. You know, let's go back to the basics. Your love for each other will never be authentic unless you love the Lord your God with all of your heart, soul, and mind. That is the greatest commandment. And the second is just like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. You see what I'm saying? When you do that, then we will have a marriage full of love, joy, fun. There's no easy marriage, you know. But I mean, at least, you know, with the struggle, you can be happy because you know that our marriage is about fulfilling God's purpose here on earth. That's why I was telling my kids, listen, marriage is not about, you know, waiting for, you know, the perfect or the beautiful girl or waiting for the perfect or handsome guy. It's not about that. It's about God's purpose. You know, I was just thinking about, you know, what Steve Martin, no, Steve Harvey, you know, Steve Harvey says, ladies, you know, if I were you, you know, I would stop trying to look for, you know, Mr. Handsome. Man, if I were you, I'd go look for an ugly man. You know what I'm saying? I've seen a lot of, beautiful young ladies, you know, that are looking for Mr. Right. You know, listen, man, it ain't about you. It's not it's easy to say because, you know, I'm about to go into 40 years of marriage, you know, but I'm telling you what I know now. You see what I'm saying? It's not about you. It's about God's purpose, you know, for people on this earth to be fruitful, multiply, replenish, subdue, and have dominion. And that's why you need two people. You see what I'm saying? Love you so much. You know, I'm praying for your marriage, you know, and I pray and hope, you know, that if you need, you know, some marital counseling, you know, Fee and I, we offer 3 marital counseling sessions. They're 1 hour apiece, you know, sometimes, you know, to go over maybe 1.5 hours, you know, not because of me and Fia, but because, you know, there's a lot of questions and concerns, you know, and so it depends on the couple. But these three sessions are free. We don't charge, you know, we just want to see marriages work. Okay. Supposed to be down in LA, you know, praying for, big brother Frank Manumanunga, you know, and his health. You know, tonight we're supposed to, you know, pay tribute, you know, to this great man, you know, that, you know, we were, you know, esteemed to be like him, you know, and, but I stayed back, you know, because, you know, my 2 daughters and my wife, Fia, you know, they have a decor business and they got an event tomorrow. And then I have a men's fellowship tomorrow as well. You know, but praying for you guys, you know, all of you that are struggling with your health, and praying for you guys as well. Okay, have a great weekend. If you're looking for a church, I recommend Sold Out Christian Center International here in the Bay Area in Antioch, California, or Sold Out Christian Center International there in Monterey, the Marina, what is the other, Salinas, you know, area, pastored by Pastor Kit and Felefele Totolo, great man and woman of God, you know, and come and taste and see how good God is under the tent and over there in Monterey. Okay, if this message has been a blessing to you, then I want you to help me reboot the church, you know, start the church all over again. You can do that by sowing a seed, 5, 10, 15, doesn't matter. I always say it doesn't matter, you know, because sowing and reaping is a principle. Whatever you give, that's what you reap. You follow what I'm saying? What I am excited about us becoming partners is that together we can build a strong foundation, you know, in the church. That way we can eradicate, annihilate, destroy, get rid of presumptions, foolishness, ignorance, and even stupidity, you know, in the church. Okay. Love you guys so much. I'll see you at the top. If you don't stop, take you out on this wedding rendition that we did for my nephew, Matt, and his beautiful wife, Nicole. Love you. Good night. You're the one.